like the way my breasts sagged and my stomach did. Because I couldn't exercise for months on end because my shoulder. You should see them now. I wish I
could. How did you decide to make the film together? When did you, tell us about the genesis of it?
Well, there's two answers to that. One is that I'm a film critic and I've been going to the film festivals for 30 plus years, and can't tell you how many times I've walked out of movies going, I could make a better movie than that. And so I said, well, maybe I'll try. And the other is that I've known Robert for 15 years, and that whole time, I always felt that this is a film that should be made, because he's a giant in the industry, and to my mind, there were three people who changed comedy at sort of the end of the 60s, Richard Pryor, George Carlin, and Robert Klein. And if you ask Jay Leno or Jerry Seinfeld or Bill Maher or Billy Crystal or Jon Stewart, which one of them was most influential, they'll say Robert.
I feel today the luckiest man facing the earth. Anybody here protests, I'll punch you right in the face. And I'll pay the legal bills. Imagine him picking a fight with the Pope. And did you hear the Pope's comeback?
Donald Trump, you're an idiot. You have a stupid attitude.
I cannot tell you what it feels like, because Marshall's original plan was based on the fact that a lot of these, the top of the crop comedians that are represented in the movie, have said in print and in public so many times how I was an influence. I think Jay's line about, when you want to go into comedy in rural Massachusetts, people go to your mother, is he over that comedy thing yet? You could point to Robert Klein, he went to college, he was normal, so to speak, and all that. When I saw some of the things that they said, and they were all so heartfelt, I said, we better have material to back it up. It almost made me nervous. The praise was so wonderful and heartfelt. It's a very surreal kind of feeling watching. I've seen myself in one over the years. I get a little twang of the heart to see Johnny Carson, who was so important to my career. And, and I may not have wanted to be married to him. He was, bad with drink and some things, and the Pall Mall's always burning down here. But he was so generous, and that made a career, because I wasn't really a guy who had a series or that sort of thing. And I just think that it got across the point that I wanted to do it on my terms, and that means reasonably clean. I mean, I used profanity, but profanity is part of the language, like anything else, when used aptly, like a good author would. And, I thought I made people think. I thought Bud's comment there, Bud Friedman, who only improv with so many people starred. So I'm just thrilled by it. There's a couple of good jokes who were covered there. He goes up to Don Rickles, I'm doing a film. Well, you heard that, right? Are you short of money, Marshall? I said, I have one guard, Wonder Woman, that was covered by a laugh. But when a laugh covers another laugh, you don't worry about it. It's a laugh, isn't it?
All right. As we were shooting this, Robert said that the motto that Rodney Dangerfield had always taught him was, if there's a laugh, segues don't matter. So we kind of followed that as we were editing.
Yeah, Robbie would tell a joke about, I'll tell you, you don't know who to believe, I just signed a big contract with General Motors. I bought a car, then when they laugh, they'll change it. But I'll tell you, last week, it doesn't matter. You get a laugh with him, you can change subjects. But I just learned technique from him, and he was an unbelievable human being. Certainly in the early time when he started his career as Rodney Dangerfield rather late. He had been Jack Roy and a quasi-successful club comedian, and his elegant daughter, is like a niece to me and very close. Could you believe that came out of Rodney Dangerfield, that beautiful woman?
I'll tell you, you don't know who to believe.
A lot of it is good luck meeting terrific people. Second City was the greatest. When David Steinberg said we were rock stars in Chicago, we were among the bohemian set, and the sort of everything just fit in perfectly. And so I think any successful career involves some good fortune, being in the right place at the right time.
Well, it's so clear that you can command any stage that you are able to appear on, and television, et cetera. Was it different to kind of have a camera all the time when it wasn't just like a show or a television appearance? Was there any trepidation about private-public separation?
I guess. He wanted to do something about my marriage. The only thing in there that, you know, People Magazine, we both wanted the house. We couldn't have the house. If we had a big house, we had to sell it. It was a pretty ugly, even the child felt that. It was a pretty ugly thing, and I think it's part of the story. We're not close, my ex-wife and I, but she sang at the Metropolitan Opera for 8 years, and she was all over the world singing, and I loved her very much, but then that was, you know, a long time ago. There was a discussion about that. Didn't want to kind of bring up old sores, and there was a camera in present a lot, and a lot of the footage, of course, never made it, but I like the idea of my family picnic every year, and my two cousins. I have another cousin here who is the first cousin of those. You want to hear a New York accent? Robin, what was that show we saw you on? I loved it. Turn my camera out. Uncle Benny, I hadn't heard my father's voice in 32 years. And Marshall found that tape from the Today Show with Gene Shalit. And it was really exciting. I didn't remember his voice being that low. He was so funny. Shalit was falling off the chair. And I got my stuff from him. My father was a textile salesman because he never even thought of being a comedian. Today there are clubs in colleges, including his son Caleb, who's here today, who got a big laugh on his jokes. He was the Boy Scout and the older boy. He never got molested.
Take some questions from the audience, but what I wanted to say first tonight, so what's an exciting thing that's happening too next door, we've got this premiere of the new Pee Wee film at 6 o'clock tonight,
yeah.
But then after that, actually, Judd Apatow is going to do a comedy stand-up with some friends, special guest Robert, as well as a couple of other comedians. It's going to be a hot ticket to get into, so I would line up early for the Pee Wee show so you can stay in. I don't know if we'll do a separate seating, but it's going to be super cool, though.
And the Pee-wee show, you must be under six. You must be a Pee-wee. Get into a Pee-wee show.
Are there any other questions?
Yes, he did. We forgive him for that. He won't do it tonight, I can assure you.
That's fine. I wonder if you could tell us what was the single most important aspect of Mr. Klein that you wanted to reveal to the audience. And Mr. Klein, I wonder if you could tell us if he succeeded.
The question is, if for Marshall, what was the single most important element that you wanted to communicate? And for Robert Klein, did Marshall succeed?
Well, obviously that he's funny all the time, but that he's also a good guy. And hopefully we've got that.
Oh, I didn't think he'd be so short. He's from Minnesota. They're very brief and quick. You know what, I hope it didn't sound pretentious or presumptuous when I said I wanted to make comedy, stand-up comedy, more important than I perceived it as a kid. When I was a busboy and a lifeguard in these hotels in the Catskills, and I saw live comedy, and it was thrilling, but they were jokes, you know. You two bald-headed men in the front row, you put your heads together, you make an ass of yourself, you know. To be smart, I was so touched when Jerry said that. I wasn't around for any of those interviews, you understand. I wasn't over there, you know, over their shoulder like the teachers at Trump University. How's the approval rating? Huh? How's the approval rating? Good? Good. All right. I just think to have done it my way, which wasn't the greatest career move. I mean, I never sold as many albums as George, Richard. Maybe my career wasn't as big in certain ways. I simply did everything. 6 Broadway shows, 40 movies. I always kept working, which is also important.
And you're still working.
I'm still working, yeah. I mean, and I enjoy it. I'm 74. I have just like I said, I have aches and pains. I don't know what's normal or what you report to the authorities. But I think work is life, in a sense, for me. Not the schedule I once had. I love time on my own. I feed the birds, I read, I swim, whatever I do. I'm glad to have calming down a little, but it's been a wonderful 50-year ride. It certainly has. Fred Willard and I went, and I said, last March was 50th anniversary, and to see that together, that scene also touched me in a great way. I mean, we know each other so long, and he's been so successful. He's such a funny, wonderful guy. So, a lot of it is nostalgia, too. I mean, it's amazing to see. I've seen myself in years as a young man, with real black hair, and now, I'm going to leave it like this. I love these guys that are 92, and they have four hairs, and they shoe polish. So I got to go with what I have, but it is strange. I'll just say one thing. I did have a talk show. You saw my mother playing piano on it. It was on USA Network. We were eventually canceled and replaced by the real estate seminar. I forgot what I was going to tell you, but anyway, I went off for a joke. You see, a good comedian does. I was talking about the talk show, but we were on once a week, and I mean, that was a way to do that. You didn't have to be there every single day asking actors what they wanted to do, but I can't remember the story.
Carol Burnett was here for the Texas Film Hall of Fame a couple of days ago, and I had the privilege of meeting her and hearing her speak. And it was interesting, she was talking about, she was also another groundbreaker in her own way, for sure television, but she was talking about a renewed life on YouTube, that people are discovering her through YouTube now, which really surprised her.
Those were those little girls at Briarcliff, where I have a house there going, Google, Google! And suddenly they see us filming, but they... Carol Burnett and I worked, I finally got a chance to work with her. And only about 3 years ago, I was her defense attorney on Law and Order, Special Victims Unit. And she got four life sentences. She was nominated for an Emmy Award for that performance. Lovely, lovely person, and tremendous talent. I also worked with Harvey Korman in a lousy film we did in North Carolina, but it was wonderful. He said, to be honest with you, I'm doing this film to keep my medical going. You're an old actor, you have practical consideration.
Any yes, go ahead. Mm-hmm.
Robert, you're exceptionally good on the harmonica. Are you self-taught?
The question
yeah,
is,
harmonica, yes. She's complimenting my harmonica playing. Thank you. I really, I'm not that good. It's good enough to get by, but years ago at the Bitter End Club on Bleecker Street in the Greenwich Village, I worked with Sonny Terry and Brownie McGee. Anyone remember them?
Yeah.
And he hooted just like that. Sonny was blind and had the biggest hands and lips you ever saw, and Brownie was lame with a high shoe and played an acoustic guitar. They worked together for 45 years and detested each other. And was, no one knew this. In the dressing room, he showed me licks on the harmonica. And he said, no, this way. And he said, and I picked up little tricks. But they called each other River. And they go, what you want, River, between shows? I don't know, River. They were kind of, Brownie was nasty. I don't know, River. What you want, River? I don't know. River? But you leave me alone, River. I don't know. I said, why do you call each other River? And Brownie said, because it goes on and on.
I will tell you that when I was editing this movie and working on it at home, every time I put any scene that had a harmonica on it, my dog sang along.
This dog, Sammy.
No!
That's right. And we'd like to thank the people that didn't come, too. The Claude Ring Society, they buy tickets, but then they don't show up, they're invisible, and it was a matinee. It was a thrill seeker.
We have a question back there.
Yeah, how much do you work out, exercise?
3 times a week, vigorously, for the last 25 or 30 years.
Use it or lose it.
Yeah, it's getting tough. I have a thing in the basement, and a trainer. I mean, he's not there for every single session, but you know what? I think it makes a big difference, because I was at a reunion with some college friends a couple of years ago in South Carolina. Doctors, judges, retired. They're
bent over, man. They look bad.
And I think they don't put out for the vigorous thing. Of course, I'll probably drop that on the treadmill one day.
Yes, good.
Yeah.
Any other
Castle Creek.
Yes.
No one heard of. Thank God. I thought it was in the Twilight Zone.
But my boyfriend and I at the time had no money, but we came and saw everything.
You know, the statute of limitations on theft of services is in Texas. I know it's a cheap shot, but you're under arrest. I was so impressed with Austin. I went to a party with McMurtry and all the literati, and it just unique to Texas. And I was here a few years ago too. Did a show. I know that Michael Dell was in the first or second row, and I forgot what the context was exactly. But I always remembered the rolling hills and the kind of hip place it is, and apparently it's caught on. I understand the building here is out of control, right? Well, everybody
are you
loves.
Touring
there? I don't tour. I go out. You know, I do a night. I have Delaware, New Jersey next week. Annapolis, Maryland. I'm doing a show in New Jersey. I just did a benefit in New York. I'm still working, but I don't go out. I don't want to be away from home too long. You know, that's one of the things. No more relocating from 6 months to Los Angeles. I love my home. I have a little apartment in New York City. That house is 45 minutes from Times Square. It's right up the Hudson. It's beautiful. Every morning I get up, and that the shade fell down. That's the first big laugh in the movie. And we didn't play it. It almost conked me on the head. It weighs about 20 pounds. I'm sort of content to work as it comes, you know, this movie, I'm looking forward to it. So I have a movie I've been doing in Canada, a drama, in the spring. I just had a running gig on Mysteries of Laura on NBC. Whether or not it's renewed, I don't know. Deborah Messing, I play her father. I play the father as a beautiful movie actress, and it's very difficult when I have to give her that little kiss on the forehead. I keep on saying, she's your daughter, but I don't get too close to the lips because incest at prime time doesn't play well in NBC. I played Kira Sedgwick's father. I played, what's her name?
Jennifer Tilly.
Jennifer Tilly, oh, that was a tough one. She'd come into work and went, God. And there was a scene where I faint and she jumps on top of me. And she's pounding my chest, Daddy! Daddy! It's an idiot, yells, cut. I go, don't cut yet, I need 12 more daddies. Maybe 12. Who was the one I did 2 weeks' notice with? Names and nouns are a little tough to get.
Sandra Bullock.
Sandra Bullock's one of them. I played her father. I actually made love to Joan Rivers in a movie. It's a whole other story.
Well, we want to thank you so much for giving that for a lifetime.
Thank you all for coming.